So welcome everyone to call two, discussion two, with Sian, Zelbo, and Sally Bishop. And everybody here is a repeat from yesterday. Bridget had mentioned that she might have a conflict and might have to watch the recording. Hi, Bridget. And the rest of you. So the flow for today's discussion will be reflecting on yesterday's puzzle and whether or not you were able to share it with the children in your lives. What are your thoughts? So, do either the Coons family or Lance have any reflections to share with us?
Yeah, so I tried the activity with my daughter. She's 8 years old. And it went pretty good. One thing that was kind of interesting was, you know, she's only in second grade, so the idea of area and perimeter is still a little new to her, so I had to kind of go over what that means. But I happened to be using colored sticks, just various colors. And so when we made the perimeter for her to count the area, she would use you know, sticks that weren't colored to make the unit squares so that she could count them easier. And that was an idea that she kind of came up with. You know, it wasn't something I suggested. So I thought that was kind of neat. So that she could keep track of counting the area, which is kind of a new idea for her.
Well, that's right. That's a new wrinkle I hadn't thought of. You know, if you start to color code the sticks, I imagine, and run through an activity, right, you'll notice different things about it. And but for her, you said it made it possible for her to keep track of the counting.
For area. Mm-hmm. And she found maybe 4 or 5 of the shapes. Mm-hmm. Pretty good. She got about half of them.
Yeah. I mean, I would say for a second grader, even really to understand the idea of area is counting those kind of invisible squares inside, right? Mm-hmm. That's a big step.
Yeah.
Right.
Any other reflections, Lance?
No, because she had fun playing with it.
Good. I'm glad. Coons family.
Well, I have a problem about using tension sticks to make as many squares and rectangles out of them without making any triangles.
So you made your own problem. That's wonderful.
So do you want to show them an example? So your limitations are how many? How many toothpicks?
10
toothpicks. With the additional rule that no triangles are to be made.
Mm-hmm. So we're counting squares or we're counting rectangles?
Both.
Okay.
Yeah, you can make a lot.
Right.
How many did you count last night when you...
16,
I think it was 18.
Yeah, it was about 18. Yeah.
Excellent.
Well, that's a wonderful example of how to make it your own problem, right? The parameter that we had used last time was triangles, right? And just by changing it into squares, you really have a completely different problem.
Yeah, and you have one.
Oh, well, yeah, well, I did come up with something as well. Can you pull that over? So I don't know if you noticed, but we were using these they're magnetic bars, and we were using those yesterday to make the different shapes. They normally have like little bars or little steel balls, you know, to connect them, but you can just use them like this too, and they make great triangles and stuff. But so in the process of playing with Geomag through the years, as a matter of fact, I've come across this design that just uses, you know, simple straight lines here, but triangles, all triangle, equilateral triangles in between.
Yeah,
and there's like a lot, like you don't think this is very much right here, but you can begin to make all kinds of interesting three-dimensional shapes. And maybe I'll bring this down to show you the three-dimensionality of it. But you can do all kinds of, you know, let me show you like this. all kinds of neat with just the triangles. Like they're, you know, they're movable, and you can just make an almost infinite number of different configurations that are really neat three-dimensional objects. So I thought, well, you know, the rest of you probably don't, you know, have geomags. I don't know if you have geomag available to you, but it allows you to really explore and play with shapes, especially things like, you know, cubes and pentagons and making like platonic solids and stuff like that. So I went ahead, and something I've been curious about for a long time, like, can I make this out of something as simple as cardboard? And so I went about doing that last night. I just used like an old cereal box that I was had within the recycling bin, and I went ahead and made this by, you know, doing the, and it was an interesting geometric problem to solve, let me say. I mean, I have an engineering background, but still it was like, it took a lot of measuring and calculating to make sure that I was getting equilateral triangles. And what I did is I just cut them all apart, and then I lightly put them together with like little strips of clear tape. So they're very movable. So I answered my question, like I'm able to go ahead and play around with them. And, you know, you can fold them over one another, and I have, you know, an octahedron here. Two faces are missing, but you get the idea of like the octahedron. And then you can also play with the whole movement aspect that has been intriguing me. You know, just doing different things to fold it over and, you know, see what you can come up with. Again, the octahedron is big, but I was also able to make it into a pyramid by folding it over. Yeah, I can't do it now, of course. Here we go. Well, I almost got it.
It's not in the camera. Can you?
I'm sorry. Yeah, well, I didn't actually succeed. This isn't the best. I thought my document camera was going to be a little bit easier to use, but anyway, so I can fold them over, and I can end up with like, I forgot what they call this—a trilateral pyramid.
A tetrahedron.
Uh-huh. It's a tetrahedron. Yeah, it's a three-sided pyramid. But again, you know, it can explore the movement aspect of what can be done with just a simple strip of triangles. And I will say that I did watch a PBS documentary many months ago that talked about, in architectural studies, a lot of times they'll use triangles because of their, you know, ability to move and be, you know, form different structures, three-dimensional structures. You know, just, I don't know, just different things that it's really not really a problem. It's just playing.
Right, but it's very rich for making problems, right? I mean, I'm writing down here, the other ones were called geomagnets.
Yeah, these are geomag, yeah.
And then the connected triangles, right? Those are two great examples that I hadn't thought of before, of components you can start with, right, and do your explorations, and then
it's pretty easy and very cheap to make too. I was surprised at how, you know, I did it in a, you know, what, 20 minutes or something last night.
Wonderful. So, I mean, as I'm watching you play, like a couple of questions come to my mind. I don't know if you know, you started to think of specific explorations that you could do, but I was thinking with the geomagnets, you know, they're different than the toothpicks we were using. Like you said, you can build them in three dimensions. And so, you know, if you use six of them and make a tetrahedron, right, that's an example. Remember, we were using, how many were we using yesterday? Six, and trying to make triangles with them. Well, if you build a three-dimensional structure, then you're counting triangles in three dimensions, and it just turns into a different problem. So that's a wonderful example. And then the folding triangles that you showed us, you can take four of those triangles and fold them into a tetrahedron. But then it makes me wonder, how many other ways could you unfold a tetrahedron, right, and get different patterns of triangles?
Well, right, because this is a pattern, this is seven, I don't know if you noticed, but it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 triangles, and I just happened to build this last night. It just happened to be seven of them. So I went ahead and I used seven here, but as you see, you can fold them in on one another and get something like the tetrahedron itself. And so it is fun, again, we're playing with platonic solids, but if you add more, you could go further. Mm-hmm. But I think that this was some of the concept that Buckminster Fuller used for the geodesic dome. Because it has pentagons in it as well. But, you know, again, they fold, you know, the triangles will fold, and you can do a variety, just, you know, almost anything your heart desires with it.
Right, and that, I mean, you could easily, I could see spending hours just doing that, building these, you know, flat shapes out of connected triangles and then exploring how they fold.
So, yeah, you could also explore with just doing different numbers. But, again, it's not really a problem per se. It's just this is something I was really personally curious about and thought I'd show it.
Uh-huh. Right. I think it's very rich. I'm gonna build one and think about it later and see what I can come up with. Thank you.
That's fascinating. Can I share some thoughts that I had since yesterday's discussion?
Sure.
So I was thinking about the different qualities of different mediums, different manipulative tools. So the original puzzle that Sean posed for our discussion yesterday used sticks. And we were talking about how the parameters of area 5 and perimeter 12 lent itself to 55 tiles. Do you remember how you said that, Sean, that at one point in your exploration you switched to 5 tiles instead of 12 sticks? Well, those are the same when you're looking at the specific problem that you had posed, but when you use sticks, 12 sticks, your hard detail is perimeter 12, everything else is variable. When you use 5 tiles, your hard detail is area 5, but everything else is variable. And so whatever your medium is, it lends itself, it has inherent hard details and variables. And there can be overlap, like the geomags and the cardboard triangles have overlap, probably more overlap than 12 sticks and 5 tiles. But every medium has its own characteristics that I think we discover as we explore with them.
Right, that's a good point. And the, it's true that the material constrains you, but at the same time, it opens up possibilities. It you see things that you otherwise wouldn't have seen. And, you know, the example of the magnets where suddenly you're building them into 3 dimensions because you weren't able to do that before is a good example of that.
Samantha and I are over here gasping in delight at the geomags. We've never played with them.
They are awesome. They're expensive, but they are so, I mean, we use them all the time for math exploration.
I imagine so.
It's just so fun. Like, I would never have discovered that you could do this with triangles had it not been the geomag, because it allows free flowing movement.
Yes.
And then I started realizing, gee, what was possible with it. But of course, they're just little bars. You know, they're just little magnetic bars with steel balls. Yeah.
So have you ever played with hexaflexagons, Terry?
Oh, no, I've seen them. They're with paper, are they not? You can make them out of, like, cardboard or paper.
Right.
I think I saw some of iHeart's videos using them, and they honestly look a little too complicated to make.
That's what I thought until this one mastered them.
Okay. Well, I bow down to you, sweetheart.
I was just going to follow up on a point about different mediums.
Yes.
So the geomags really stress the vertices and the edges if you make, like, say, a polyhedron. But there's also these space chips. Has anyone played with these?
Oh, no, I've seen those before, though.
Yeah, and they really stress the faces when you build polyhedra. And so I just thought it's kind of a nice, kids get to play with then, you know, close together in time, they kind of see the difference between stressing the faces versus the edges and the vertices. You can build the same type of shape.
So I was just going to show you, just so you know, the Geomag, you can buy different, they're called panels, and they snap in. So they do give you a little bit of an illusion of that face, not as strongly as this, I don't know, what you call this face one?
Face chips.
Face chips, yeah. But anyway, so you can purchase those as well. They give a little bit more structure to your three-dimensional objects and for your building as well, because when you're building something that, you know, say you're building a multi-level building, you know, it'll give additional stability because, as you can see, the movement is very fluid around these steel balls, so it can lose, you know, solidity quickly. Oh, we can't hear you.
Yeah, Samantha keeps reminding me that I've forgotten that I've muted myself.
Does anybody have any other favorite math materials to use?
We also love Cuisenaire rods. We use those a lot.
I have those, but I don't use them very much. The most interesting thing we've done is we've built them all from largest to smallest pieces and made a Tower of Pisa, or I mean a Eiffel Tower, right? Not Pisa, that one. Yeah. What do you do with them?
Well, gosh, we've modeled math concepts. Like when, for instance, she was learning division with larger numbers, like say, dividing double digits into triple digits, it became a way to model the different sets and the groups that you were dividing into. And that's a very quick way to do it. Well, let's put 10 in each set, so you get a 10 rod. Okay, now how much more can we put? I think we can fit a 6. We can do a 6 rod next, instead of using individual, you know, unit cubes or whatnot. So, but we've used it for tons of things, with fractions and everything.
Okay.
Maybe we have this interesting sound filter again, where you sound higher.
Oh, I'm sorry. You know what? It must be my document camera. I can take that off now since we're done showing. Let me do that.
Could you tell me what those were? I didn't catch the name.
Geomags?
No, for the Eiffel Tower thing and the fractions. What was?
Sally.
You're muted.
Thank you. Cuisenaire rods.
What is it?
Cuisenaire.
Oh, okay. Got it.
So, yeah, there's a 10 unit, a 9 unit.
All the way down to one.
Yeah, I've put it in chat.
There we go. Okay.
Oh, you sound grown up again.
Is my voice better now?
Well, yeah. it was very cute. It just sounded like you are a 5-year-old. It's all good. Just an interesting effect there.
Yes. I'm sorry. It must be something with something must be wrong. I don't know how to make that better.
I think it catches some frequencies and not others, but it's a perfect imitation. Like you could really be a voice actor for a cartoon.
Like a chipmunk.
Not what I was looking for, but thank you.
Okay. All right. Lens. The Cuisenaire rods are, there are actually a lot of materials for them online. And I wanted to throw in an idea. I really like virtual manipulatives for some things. So there are by now virtual manipulatives of all of those popular things and building materials, and of course big environments like Minecraft where you can build and build, but the things you can do with virtuals you can't do with physical is copy and paste. So if you build something like one of those flexagons, you can build a bunch of them right away. And another one you can undo. because I'm telling you, when I'm building and it all crashes down, where is my undo button? Okay, and and another one with virtual is, well, you can keep building and it, you can share easily. Like, I could send you, I can send you my stuff. Oh, those are the rods. Maybe you can show some things with them. Okay, I'm done with my spiel on virtual stuff, but I like to play with computers.
So I took off the document camera, so I can't show you down on the table anymore. But this is like a 10 rod, and what it represents is that here's a unit rod, and 10 unit rods will actually fill a 10 rod. And each number, so you have numbers 1 through 10. Here's 9, here's 8. And you can use them to measure, you can use them to show even things like fractions. Like, let's take a 9 rod. How many, 3 is how much of 9? Well, we can fit 3 of these 9 or 3 rods onto the 9. Mm-hmm. So this is 1/3 of the 9 whole.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So it's a way of just, you know, showing things. It's like, instead of using base 10 blocks, a lot of times we'll grab these because, I don't know, sometimes it just gets easier. Instead of picking out 6 unit blocks, I can just pick out, you know, one of these, which is the 6 rod.
So what is that, an 8 rod?
Yes. So 4 is 1/2 of the 8 because 2 of them fill up the whole 8.
Mm-hmm. Very nice.
So we don't use them all the time, but every now and again, these are just like the perfect tool. So
I'm trying to think of some of my go-to materials. A few years ago, I found online that I could buy 1,000 tiny little wooden unit cubes. They're just meant to be blocks, except they're perfect because they're not painted. Like, you can draw on them, so you can make dice. You can build with them, so it can represent a unit cube. And, you know, that was years ago, and I treat them almost like they're disposable because I have this endless supply. And that's been one of my favorite materials. And I also love dominoes, right? We get used to playing dominoes sort of in the traditional way, but if you just explore with them, it turns out you can do a lot with them. Like, you can think of the dominoes as a ratio of numbers, right? Since there are 2 numbers on a domino. You can also make patterns of them and look at the sums of the different lines and rows, and, you know, you can make a challenge for yourself to try to make all of the sums equal. Just really anything with numbers on it or anything with a discrete length, like the blocks that you're talking about, make wonderful manipulatives, right? You just start playing and notice things about them and make your own questions. Let's see. Should we, do you mind if we go back just for a moment to the question that we were talking about yesterday? Because I was trying to, let me just share my screen here. Hold on. See if I can find it. I was trying to remember, can you see it? Yes. I was trying to remember the solutions that we came up with, right, for how many triangles we could make. And, right, these, especially these beautiful symmetrical solutions intrigued me, like the one you came up with, Kuhn's family, and actually I think you came up with this one as well. I don't think as a group we ever found a solution to 7, so I don't know if somebody figured that out last night.
I can try right now.
Do you want to try? You want to take a minute and do that? So the task was, we have 7, let's not worry about the length anymore, right? It's just 7 I'm sorry, six straight lines, and we're trying to make seven triangles out of it. So here, I'm trying to unmute people here.
Here, I think this one works. I showed it yesterday at the end, but I had too many lines in. I used seven lines yesterday.
Four, five. So let's count. One there. Let's see. One, two, three. Two, three, four, five, six. One, two, three, four, five, six. I'm counting eight.
Are you? Did I do it wrong again? So there's one, two, three, mm-hmm. And the big one is four, and then five, six, and then there's a little one here to make seven.
Oh, well, I was also counting how the triangle's broken into three large triangles, or, right? If you take any two of them at a time.
You're right. Right. You're right. Yeah, you're right.
I think I came up with here.
You're right.
I came up with something. We take one of the other solutions, right? The solution for, and just tweak it a little bit to get rid of one of these triangles. Does that work? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven.
Mm-hmm.
Am I counting right?
Yeah, I think you got it.
I see seven.
I see seven.
Did somebody else come up with a solution?
No.
I think I've got seven here.
Maybe seven here.
All right, let's see. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. I think you're right. I think that's seven. Anyway, so this was a rich problem, and then one of your solutions that occurred to me, that it was here. Let me see if I can share this. Here we go. Hold on a second. Here it is. Can you see this?
Yes.
All right, so there were so many triangles here, right? And this solution that you guys came up with, I think what we had settled on yesterday is that there were a lot, and we didn't know how many. But it was an interesting problem in itself just to find a way to count them all and to figure out, you know, how do I know when I'm done? How do I know that I got them all exactly wants, and I'm still not sure I did, but I was trying to organize them by, you know, types of triangles. So I classified them, maybe six of these, you know, little triangles. And then if I join two little triangles together at a time, I get a medium triangle, and there are three of those. And then six triangles, I think, of this type, where you join three little triangles together. Anyway, my only point was that I actually spent a good 15 minutes thinking through this. And, you know, it was a good example to me of how, you know, the exploration and the problem can open up new problems to you.
I just had a thought too, while we were looking for a solution of seven triangles, I was wondering if the answer would lie in asymmetry. And most of the solutions that everyone came up with were not symmetrical, except Sean's. Yours was symmetrical. And I wondered if seven was going to correlate to asymmetry, but apparently not.
Oh, right. Well, that's another thing that we hadn't even focused on yet. Right? Mm-hmm. And you could make it, if it turns out it's too easy to make triangles, right, and it's no longer interesting, then that would be an interesting way to restrict it, for example, to say, okay, for now we only want symmetrical solutions. Or I know when I'm working with kids sometimes with numbers, and, you know, we play math dice quite a bit, where you roll dice and you try to combine the numbers to make some target number. And if it gets, sometimes I'll say to them, I only want elegant solutions, or you get, you know, style points for elegant solutions, right? So it's a good, you know, you could do that with the triangles as well.
Samantha has something she'd like to share.
Oh, you have math dice too?
Handy, yes. We keep it on the table. We do it during meals.
That's funny, because I used to do that with my kids too when they were little. They've outgrown math dice, but we used to literally play it at dinner and in restaurants, and it was just always with us. It never gets old, does it?
Nope. It's always a challenge. And you know what? So often now she wins. She gets it a lot faster than I do. And she's like, Mom. And I'm like, well, I just didn't see it. When you don't see it, you don't see it.
Wonderful.
Answers. She doesn't get the flexagon.
Oh, let's see.
Build one.
First, I'm just folding the paper into equilateral triangles.
It's the same principle with the triangles and a strip.
It is. That's what brought it to her attention.
I didn't remember that.
She'll fold the whole strip that way, and then there's a construction after that. Getting the first triangle folded took a lot of practice, because you're eyeballing an equilateral triangle out of a rectangle. Mm-hmm. She's gotten really good at it.
So what do you do with it once it's folded?
You fold it into a hexagon. So this one can go like that. And then you cut off the excess and then tape.
And then it folds inside out ad nauseum.
Oh, that would be fun to color, right? Is that what you do with them? You color them?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you can make them more than one go around, so then when you keep folding it inside out, there's more layers than if it's one go around. There's different varieties. She was very excited to show the hexaflexagon after seeing triangles, Terry.
I want to see what you can do with it, though. I don't think I saw the hexagon yet.
Okay. Well, she needed tape to do the next step. Can you hold it up so they can see what you're doing? So can you see right here, we have the beginnings of a hexagon?
Yes.
And now she's going to cut off the tabs of leftover paper.
Oh, so you can almost make this any size at all. So you're just trimming it. Okay.
So there's one overlapping triangle.
Okay.
And it has a funny, because the triangles were folded every, you know, back and forth. It has
sure. Yep.
That action going on. Make sure they can see it. And then you pinch it, and it opens up.
Yes, okay. It's just like origami. Mm-hmm. Where you get their basic, your basic fold, your primary fold does look very similar.
Yeah.
And then do you put a bunch of them together?
Can you make, so you had it go around in one circle, can you make them where it goes around in two circles? I thought you did. How do you make it?
This four sides.
What, four sides? 19 triangles instead of 7, instead of 9. This is, it's not. Because it looks like 6. But then you had 2 overlap. Oh, okay, so they are 9 because there's 2 for this one. And there's 1 for this one, and there's 2 for this triangle, and there's 1 right here. I see. So that's 9. I don't know how to build the other kind. Only she does.
Well, I don't know. Yeah.
But thanks to my heart. You're muted, Terry.
I think that's amazing. And I mean, Veronica's already gotten a strip of paper and started. She's like, how do I do the rest of it? I'm like, I don't know. We're going to have to look it up. But now I can guarantee you that's a project we'll be, you know, pursuing. So thank you.
Excellent.
Thank you for showing us. I don't know your name, but thank you, dear.
Samantha.
Really cool. Like our little Vi heart in training.
Yes.
Maybe they can keep meeting and doing things together.
I think that would be lovely.
Sometimes it's something that I'd like to help people do, just meet and continue talking, because face-to-face mass circles do it really well. Well, you get to meet people and you are in the same area, so you can go have lunch together or play date. So how can we do it online when people click? How can they keep meeting and care for one another in the context of mathematics?
That's
cool. Something to think about.
Those of us who love math need a lot of care and love. Oh, you're muted.
And we deserve it.
And we deserve it. But it's not easy in coming, is it?
Yeah. Wonderful. Okay, so I'm trying to figure out where we're at in the flow of our discussion. Everyone got to reflect on sharing the activity, and Veronica shared her new puzzle with us. Lance, did you play with the creation of new puzzles at all?
No, I did not really. I played around a little bit with adding letters to the tips of like the sticks and trying to do something where you have to match the letters and make that, but yeah, nothing too interesting really came out of playing around with it.
Well, I would say that you were on step 2, which is playing around.
Yeah.
And you hadn't done enough of step 2 to get to step 3, which is to find the interesting questions.
Yeah, one thing that I had in mind was, and I think this has probably been done before, but you know, like Euler circuits on a graph, how you have to travel every edge exactly one time. And I thought about, if all the sticks have like the one, all the ones that have A, for example, if you pile them on top of each other, that becomes like a vertex with edges. And so somehow taking, you know, these things we were making and also looking at corresponding variety. But anyway, I never really got that far.
Well, it's interesting you mentioned that, because in this the book that I'm writing that this came from, there's a chapter on graphs.
Oh, okay.
They're very rich for this sort of exploration, right? I thought, you know, for our purposes, I wanted to use something that adapts well to every age level. So, you know, to use something as simple as paper or as toothpicks is perfect for this purpose. But, you know, there are these more abstract materials, you know, like graphs that you can use that lead to some really interesting questions. So what's, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Maybe you can look at the chapter together and see the connections Lance made and you made. Just interesting to compare notes. I know your book has a lot of connections in particular, and that's what makes it so rich. Interesting that this bridge was made kind of naturally here.
That's true. So Sally, what's the next step?
Do we want to talk more about the aspects of puzzle building? Reflecting on your steps of choose your medium, play with it, and then think of interesting questions.
Well, I have a question to throw out. Is that hard? It's my experience in working with teachers and parents that's the step where it becomes hard. And I'm just wondering if you have any thoughts about that.
I think sometimes when you venture into new material, it's hard to know what it looks like without experiencing it or seeing what it looks like when other people do it. Mm-hmm. And so it might be the kind of thing that grows better when you explore with other people and we reflect on each other and we make observations that the other person didn't see. I certainly think that there's probably benefit in together explorations. Certainly there's a time for, you know, the quiet, personal, introspective kind of exploring. But I think a lot more comes when we do it with other people.
I think you're right. And I think we also need to be patient with ourselves about the time that it takes to just to play and explore, and that's time that's well spent, right? Even though play gets a bad rap, it's productive time and it's necessary, right? You have to be really comfortable with the material before you become curious about it and start noticing things and asking questions, right? Like looking at your hexaflexagons, like I couldn't begin to ask an interesting question about it because I would need to sit down with it for a couple of hours and really play with it and get to know it.
And not just a couple of hours, but then let it percolate in the back of your mind while you go about your life, because a lot of that processing happens over time.
That's absolutely true.
Is funny, is it surprising how much psychology is involved in math? Because when I asked Lance, did you create a new problem? He was like, no, I didn't, except I did all of this stuff, except I'm almost at asking interesting questions. He didn't see it that way. And so I think sometimes we can do a lot of validating for other people and their observations.
That's true. should we go through maybe one more example? Do people have time to do that? I was thinking we could try a new material, a new medium, and just see what comes of it. Sally asked people just to bring paper. I just took some plain paper and just cut each one into four pieces. But for our purposes, the edges don't even have to be straight. It doesn't really matter what size they are or what shape. Origami paper is beautiful. It doesn't have to be origami paper though. So one of the chapters of the book is about paper folding. And I just think, you know, it's a good example of how you can, again, take something that's so simple and it leads to some really, or it can lead to some really interesting questions. But maybe the first thing I'd like people to do is simply to fold your paper. Maybe take a few pieces of paper and fold them. And I, as you fold them, I want you to, I'm kind of moving us a little quicker through the process than I would if I were doing this through a math circle, because I want, you know, I want you to see more examples of what I'm talking about. So, you know, if I were working with kids, we probably would spend time really just playing with the paper and folding it, and then maybe the kids would find a way to introduce their own questions or their own notation. But right now I'm going to introduce a notation, which is this. If you've used origami before, you'll know what I mean by a mountain fold and a valley fold, right? And there's a notation used where a mountain fold is a straight line and a valley fold is a dotted line. So a mountain fold means it folds like a mountain. A valley fold means it folds under, right? Folds the other way. So you might notice that every fold really is a mountain fold and a valley fold, depending on what side you're looking at. But so it doesn't matter which side of the paper you use, just pick one and stick to it. So I've folded this paper twice, right? And then unfolded it and marked it. So let's all take, you know, a couple of minutes to fold paper in different ways. You don't have to fold it beautifully, just randomly is fine. And then mark it with the mountain and valley folds. There you go. Nice. So I see three of your folds marked. Did you mark all four of them? Veronica, can I see again? Here. Here. Oops. Oh my goodness. That one looks like a spider's web.
Or even like a tombstone, now that you go with the Halloween theme.
Uh-huh.
Let's do something else. It's not a tombstone. It's a smile.
It's something happy, right?
Right. A big nose. I don't know.
All right. Can people show me what they have? I did a few different ones here. All sort of different. Yeah. Oh, beautiful. Oh, interesting. Okay.
I missed Lance's.
Yeah.
Okay.
So one thing I
made a twofold. Mm-hmm. Not much.
So one thing that I noticed is that some of us stuck with things that were simple, and some people want to get as complicated as they can right away, like Sally. And then Maria's is a little bit different than mine because my folds went straight through, mm-hmm. and Maria's did not.
Same with Lance. Right.
To make flying, like kind of like a bird thing,
mm-hmm.
dimensional. Well, it's I made the box accidentally. I don't know what bird it is. Maybe a penguin. But I really am interested in freeform origami. I think I have a couple here. Ray made. Okay, this is Ray's penguin with my child's always a baby penguin. So that's just like free fold thing. And I think I have one more here. So this is a or something like that. Manatee. So this is a different style of origami than like free fold. So I was trying to kind of make it with straighter folds but also free, and then no, that will take more experimentation.
You know, Maria, I always think in regards to origami that it has to start somewhere. So it's exactly this kind of playing around that people can develop their actual models that they can have directions to folding.
Mm-hmm.
Here's mine.
I'm wondering, I mean, I've sort of did my own exploration, obviously, of this earlier, but I'm wondering, is there anything people noticed as they were folding or as they were drawing in their mountains and valleys?
Well, just how the paper itself takes on different contours as you fold it in different ways. And it mm-hmm. becomes, you know, it obviously goes from 2D to 3D very quickly.
I was noticing that too. I was trying to make a three-dimensional object, and it's very easy to go into the third dimension. But it's hard to be purposeful about it. Like, I thought I would fold it like that and it would do a thing, but it didn't do the thing. Uh-huh. It was just one fold. So it's
not to be like.
Wow. What is it, Veronica?
I have no clue.
An abstract piece of art, right?
Actually, I think I got some.
And I find myself looking at the patterns in the valleys versus mountains. So this one is symmetrical because I did one straight across fold. And I have valley, 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 mountain. Mountain, 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 valley. And I suppose one could learn how to look at a drawing and know exactly what it's going to do, depending on whether it's mountain or valley.
Mm-hmm. In fact, I wonder, so Sally, one thing you pointed out that I think is really important, and it was obvious in Lance's drawing too, the symmetry, right? Because you have that clear fold down the middle, and then you have, right, the folds coming out from the center. That you can think of that line as a line of reflection, and observe how the folds are reflected across it. So that's really interesting. I wonder also, you know, so Sally, you're raising another question. Can you look at a pattern and know how it was folded, right? That's a really interesting question. Or can you look at a pattern of folds and know whether it's a possible fold or whether it's an impossible fold, right?
I believe that you can. I saw Robert Lang talk at a science thing up here at our university, and he's an amazing mathematician, origamist, and he's one of the guys that's pioneered computer modeling to design origami folds. And while they were picking him up from the airport and driving an hour and a half up to our town, they challenged him, he said, I can fold anything. You can fold anything. Okay, so they drove by the bull statue for our university because we're Aggies, and he got out a dollar bill, and like in 5 minutes, he had this perfect bull. Because he's so practiced, he can see it's, you know, he has that going on in his mind. That was fascinating. Right.
It also reminds me of, I don't know if, you know, those of you who are old enough will remember before there were Google Maps, there were paper maps.
And,
you were trying to navigate in the car, you would take the map out of the glove compartment and it would unfold into this enormous thing, and then you always had to refold it. And, you know, the idea of looking at the folds and figuring out how the map is supposed to be folded, I always was fascinated by, like, how could anybody possibly solve that? But this is a good place to start.
Right.
I wonder,
unbroken line.
Exactly. Right. Can you look at my silly little puzzle here and figure out which was the first fold that I made?
Yeah,
right.
Down one.
You see that? Or Lance, can you show yours again? You see it? Let's look at Lance's and see if we can figure it out. Which was the first, his first fold?
Diagonal one.
Yeah, I think you're right.
But he did that by pinching and folding it over, I think.
Mm-hmm. I am muted, Lance.
It was just in half, or, you know, diagonally and then over.
Mm-hmm. Like that. Mm-hmm.
Right, so this is, already we have a lot of interesting questions, right? We could make different kinds of puzzles. We could, right, the how many puzzles, right? We could say, well, suppose we're gonna allow ourselves two and only two folds. How many different patterns can you get? Right, that's an interesting question. Or the is it possible questions, right? Is it possible to fold a paper in a way that that I have more than one unbroken line like this, right? And Sally's, right, here I only have one unbroken line, right? All of the others sort of switch from mountain to valley. Whoops, no, actually I have two.
Two valley.
Yeah, because I folded it, right, because those folds didn't cross. But those sorts of questions, the is it possible questions. You can also make puzzles for yourself. You can draw a mountain and valley fold. I just drew this. I didn't fold it. But it looks like it could be something that I could produce by folding, right? So I wonder if I'm right. Maybe, let's see. I guess I would fold it this way first. Whoops, you know what? I realized just by doing that I was wrong. You see why I was wrong? I mean, it looks like it could have been folded that way, but once I fold this over, I see that it's not, these lines don't lie on top of each other anymore. That fold couldn't have been produced that way, right? So that's an interesting kind of puzzle, a little challenge for yourself to draw in folds and then see if you can actually fold the paper that way.
But you can always do it, you know, you can always just do half of it. You know, start from the middle and only fold the one half of it. So you can always do those folds.
You're right. So to make the question more interesting, I have to impose another restriction, right? Which is that the folds have to go all the way through.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I thought of something. So I made this pattern and I didn't color it yet. It's in pencil. So there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 lines here, right?
Really?
And I can flip a coin for each one and draw, you know, mountain or valley, heads for mountain, tails for valley. And then I can see, can I fold it that way?
Oh, right.
And how many are there? Like all the questions you had, how many are there? Is it possible? How do we know we found all of them? All those. And even with just two lines, so let's say I just had two, well, 1, 2, 3, 4, like if I had just this part, I could still be doing it. I could just assign in them and seeing if I can do it.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. I feel very inspired.
But I feel confident that by playing around with it in this way and asking your own questions, I mean, I haven't seen one of those old maps in many years, but I feel pretty sure I could get to the point where I could actually fold one of refold one of those maps and get it right.
Samantha, so would like to show yours.
Oh my goodness. So I love that one because it makes the symmetry, the line of symmetry and the reflections really obvious.
She noticed it looks like a basketball when it's opened up.
A basketball? Can you show again? Oh, it sure does.
And then the way she wrote her name, she wrote the letter S like a mountain fold and the letter A like a valley fold. Like a mountain fold.
Because they alternate. So another sort of direction that you can take is, I didn't ask people to bring a hole punch, but this idea, you know what, I can do it with scissors. This idea that when we unfold something, it's as though we're reflecting what's on one side across the paper to the other side. You can actually fold a piece of paper and then punch a hole in it and, or cut, maybe here's what I'll do. I just folded a piece of paper twice, right, into fourths, and then I'm gonna cut a little triangle out of it. And it's a nice puzzle to think about, to unfold it in your head and try to predict where these cuts are going to end up in the unfold. Oh, you have a hole punch. That's perfect. Can you hand it to me? Just text it to me.
Times like this, I wish we were in the virtual world and doing virtual manipulatives, and I could just copy and paste my favorite hole punch a few times.
Oh, actually, you know what? I think I have one.
I play this game where I show people. Oh,
sorry. Whoa!
Where I show people how I fold the paper and then how I punched it, and then ask how many holes. Is that what you played, Sean?
Well, it's, I guess I was asking something a little bit different, which is just where are the holes, right? And of course you can't get it exactly right. But here I folded it twice and I've punched a hole, right? So it is an interesting question, how many holes, but can you also tell me where they would be?
Close to the fold line.
Yeah, well, we can think of every fold as a line of reflection, so it gets reflected to the other side, right? And then when I unfold it again, it gets reflected again. So that's, right, those are nice puzzles you can make for each other.
I missed the hole punch discussion. Apologies.
All right.
Catch me up.
So the idea is that you can make a whole other series of puzzles and explorations by folding and then printing a hole. So one example is, so you can see how I'm folding this, right, which is sort of randomly, mm-hmm. and then I'm going to punch a hole in it. Right, so Maria says that she likes to ask the question, how many holes are there going to be when I unfold it? But you can also ask where the holes are going to be.
Okay, Sean, here is an interesting thing. I usually don't ask how many questions at all. Usually they are boring because there are more interesting holes, mm-hmm. holes and questions and so on, rabbit holes to chase. Okay, but with this one, it kind of almost is implied, like where the where question, the topology and geometry question is almost implied in how many. Because look, so I'm folding, let's play just one round. I want to show what I mean, because this is very exciting between our two questions, this kind of creative tension between where and counting, like this, and I'm folding like that. So this is my fold, this is the edge, and I'm going to make some holes at different places. So here, at the tip.
Oh, that changes everything.
That changes everything, but that's a where question. Here, okay, my should have used thinner paper. Okay. Okay, and here, and I will make one in the middle. Okay, what's going on here? I'm trying. Somehow the edge worked better. I think I broke my whole punch of it. Okay, now. I'll use thinner paper next time. It's one of those things when you prepare a math circle, you always try things at home. And with one child, it's okay. Your child will be patient enough. If you have 10 people right now, like in a math circle, 10 5-year-old kids, you lost them already. Okay, unless you do this clowning thing like, ooh, it's so hard. And okay, but so the question is how many? But the question is where, like how many is index? Okay, who thinks when I open it, how many holes there will be?
I need a minute to think about that.
I'm just going to take a random guess and go. Mm-hmm.
Let's say five.
I'm going to say 8 too. That's what I think.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm going with.
So I'm going to open it once.
Seven, five, seven, and eight.
We have different. I love it when there are different answers. Then everybody wins because there is creative tension and drama. Okay, so I am opening it once. So see how my paper is.
Yeah. Seven.
What do you think now?
Seven.
Who said seven? Sally, you did?
Sally did.
Yeah, I'm sticking with eight.
Stick with eight. And I'm going to open it one more.
Oh, wow. There's more layers there than I thought.
Uh-huh.
So are you done? Are you done unfolding?
It's all open now.
Yeah, okay. So it's seven.
That one in the middle isn't really a circle, though.
No, and then you can ask question geometry versus topology. Mm-hmm. In topology, this is still a hole. In geometry, it's a whole different. It's a different thing. It's like bigger and not a circle. So, do you take issue with that being different from that, or do you not?
So I have the right topologist to answer, and Veronica has the right geometry answer.
Yeah, because I was going to say hers are two intersecting circles, so eight would be right, geometrically speaking.
And when you play those things with children, like where will the hole be, or how many, like any things, let them touch your paper. I can't do that. Hi, TJ. I can't do that here, but touching for some people makes all the difference in how they think about it. Because some people can't even speak without holding the object or can't start thinking about it. I don't know if any of your children are like that. I have one of those. Okay.
Thank you, Maria. That's something I hadn't thought of. Somehow your how many question was more interesting than the where question even. I mean, but you're right, they're related.
They're like, that's what blew my mind and made me talk for so long, I'm sorry. But it blew my mind how it's like two sides of the same question almost.
Right.
They're essential. You have to ask both together to solve.
I never thought about it this way either. But they are together and it's all one and the same.
Mm-hmm. I also have a question. So I made this. And this is going to turn into a diamond. How many diamonds do you think I'll have after I unfold it?
How many times did you fold it?
Let me check.
She's got to hide it while she counts. One, two, three. That's three folds.
Seven.
Show them. Three folds.
So that's going to be three folds. How many do you think I'll have?
I'm going to say four.
Because it depends on how many folds are on the edge that you cut.
Right.
I think three. I think all three. Let me see. All three. Yeah.
So you cut a fold or you cut an open edge?
She cut a fold. She cut a fold. So... Okay.
I'm sticking with my answer.
Six.
Are we looking at how many triangles?
How many diamonds?
All right, how many diamonds? Six, maybe?
How many?
Six.
Six, he says. Okay, you and Sally agree.
Five.
And that was interesting there. Will we even have diamonds? Maybe we'll have triangles.
Well, Samantha says five.
Can you unfold it dramatically for us?
Do it in front of the camera.
You're right, there's four.
Five. No. Oh, there's five.
No, this one is from another
That was from five. So that was from before. I didn't know that.
Yeah, I did another one there, but there's four.
So this was from the actual cut, and four was the right answer.
Nice. Okay, four was the right answer. Awesome.
All's right with the world.
Do you know what that showed me is it's important to, if you're going to make an accurate guess, you need to know how it's folded.
Yeah.
For someone to show you a piece of paper that you don't know how it's folded, it's almost impossible to make an accurate guess. I mean, I guess there are other detective clues you could look for, but it's more challenging.
Right, although it's a good task to have to formulate your own questions, mm-hmm. right? How many times was it folded? Did you cut through the fold? Mm-hmm. Right? It makes it a harder question.
Mm-hmm.
Samantha, do you want to make a problem for us? Do you want to fold your paper and cut it?
Yeah. Folded four times, and that's what I cut.
Okay.
This is the basketball piece. Do you remember how that sort of...
Oh.
The basketball fold?
Here, hold it closer. There we go.
Six or 12?
I'm going with eight or nine. Probably nine. Eight.
Is that your final answer?
Turn it over and my mind is blown when you turned it because it's it goes halfway.
Yes, it does go halfway. It's a unique fold. Okay, so let's unfold it for the camera.
4, 6, 8. Wow.
14?
We have one of these circle slash holes over here that isn't really a circle.
16, 17.
Nobody guessed that.
If that counts as one, it's 17. If this counts as two, it's 18.
Oh,
wow. Hello.
Oh, come on. Okay, mine is a lot easier. Mine is just two folds and one triangle cut because I don't have a hole punch. It's just two folds.
4. Mine says 2.
So it'll unfold into a diamond. So how many diamonds?
Well, hold it. Wait, hold it still. On the other side. Can you turn it around? Yeah, I need to think about it. I'm going to say 4.
I say 5, because I really don't know.
I'll go with 4.
All right.
6.
Maria, any guesses?
2? I'm going to change mine to 2.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, well, here we go.
Oh man. Bad move. Well, it's only a bad move if being right is important.
Which of course it's not here at Natural Map.
I just want to see, because this is a very interesting point, how we speak about it. We say fold it twice, or and what does it mean? Can you fold it again, Terry?
Did I say fold it twice? Because you know why I think I was wrong? I was folded 3 times. 1, 2, and 3. It was folded 3 times. So I gave you incorrect information.
Tricks.
That's why I changed my answer.
And this is actually...
But I set you up.
But here is the thing that's beautiful, because you can play the liar's game too, from Camp Logic, Sean. do we say correct information? Maybe we say 3 pieces of information and 2 of them are correct or something like that.
So I'm wondering, when people are making their guesses, how are you figuring it out? I mean, I can tell you when I do it, I'm literally trying to unfold it in my head. Do people have other ways of thinking about it?
I take a random guess.
I would wager, though, that there's intuition beneath your random guess that you're still consciously working on the language for.
That's true.
I'm constantly trying to figure out how many layers of paper are under each part.
Yeah.
To figure out, you know what I mean? But I gave you incorrect information, I think, because I just unfolded it part way for myself. And I said it was just 2 folds, so, yeah.
How do you guess, Lance? Layers or folds or something?
Yeah, it's how many layers are behind it when it's punched, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you kind of double, right? Because if it's folded once and you punch somewhere in the middle, then it'll double. If it's on an edge, it won't.
But yeah. Like on Sam's, you couldn't see the one edge that made that one kind of double hole.
Mm-hmm.
Because the way the paper was folded, you know, where the cut was, there was another fold that kind of went part way through it.
Right.
So she's poked 2 more holes and she's wondering if anybody wants to guess this one.
I do want to guess. Can you just hold it still for a minute so I can unfold it? Mentally.
Yeah. Do you need Dramamine?
Well, 28.
I'm going to go with the same numbers before.
I'm going to say 12.
28.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
Sure.
Okay.
Oh my goodness.
So, sorry. There's a half hole up here.
It's just a little bit more like 19.
Before it was 17.
It's, yeah, now it's 19. So it's two and a half. 19 and a half.
Half here and a half here.
Oh, is there another half? Okay, 20.
Yeah. If you add the halves. Right.
Wow.
Fun stuff.
All right.
Samantha has one more thing to show. She colored the hexaflexagon so that you can get a feel for how the layers change. So that's red.
Uh-huh.
Purple.
That's very cool.
And blue. There's three colors.
Wow.
Red. Purple. And then blue.
All blue is showing, red is showing.
So there's an inside color and two outside colors?
Right.
And then all this red is showing, purple is showing. And
blue is on the inside. Yeah. Good observation, Sean. I'm still working it out.
That's very cool.
Thank you. Thank you, Samantha.
I have something else, too. How many... shapes do we go have with this?
The diamonds again?
Well, I kind of messed up, so this is going to be like a really big shape. But, yeah. How many do you
do? How many folds did you do? Try to be accurate, unlike your mom. That's one, two, three. So she's got three folds, too.
Yeah.
Hold it up.
Twelve, nine.
I don't know. There's a part of the fold is very confusing to me, but I'll say 12.
Hold on. I'll go with 16.
16. Wow, I didn't expect that at all.
Is that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10?
Who said 10? Maria.
Yeah. Good job.
I was expecting 12 because
I've played this game hundreds of times.
There would be 6. And then when you unfold it again, there would be 12.
That's exactly what I was thinking too. You double it and then double it again. Yeah.
That's a good theory. Well, we are approaching 5 minutes till the end of our discussion, and I think that we covered a lot of ground. I really enjoyed our call today. Any last thoughts or questions, suggestions? How will you use it? Will you use this in your math circles?
Yeah, it's very possible. I'll have to see if I can make a whole list of some of these things. Yeah.
Because it's okay if steps 1, 2, and 3 take time, right?
Mm-hmm. Right. I'm particularly interested in whether the workshop has helped you think about how to structure a math circle and how to kind of open things up and how to make your own math and ask your own questions. I mean, I hope that it's helped you to do that. I've gotten some wonderful ideas from you guys, so I appreciate it.
I definitely think collaboration has a synergizing effect. I was familiar with the material while I prepared to help do this discussion, but I learned so much, and I saw things in new ways because I saw them through your eyes. It's really helpful to me too.
All right.
And I learned a new thing about my old game. I'm so thrilled.
Breathing new life into it, Maria.
It's always interesting how a lot of math circle leaders say we keep learning about this. And when we feel like we don't, then it's time to get a new activity from someone else.
Well, this, I would just like to say this was a wonderful use of our time in what is already a very busy day. I can't think of something more enriching that we could have done. So, I mean, just thank you, ladies, for putting this together, because we've really enjoyed it, and it's given us a lot of additional things to think about in our regular math lessons. Thank I mean, you. Interestingly enough, this came around at the perfect time because she's just finished the unit on area and perimeter, and she's just started on geometry itself, and it's been perfect timing. So it's been enriching every which way.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right.
All right. Well, thank you, Sian, and thanks for letting us use material from your book. I look forward to seeing the whole thing.
All right.
I don't mean to interrupt you, Lance.
No, I was just going to say thanks, and our master school starts in April, so I have some time to think about how to work this in. So.
That's great. All right.
Well, thanks, everyone. That was wonderful.
All right.
Hope to see you again soon.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.